Part of the reason I love to run is because my sister loved to run. And I remember our school that we went to was named Ligonia Elementary. And every year it had what was called the Ligonia Olympics. And so every class would compete against each other. So fifth grade, all the four classes in fifth grade would compete, sixth grade class, seventh grade class. And so our family, I think genetically, has always been just really good athletes and really good runners. And my sister, being the oldest, was the first one that I got to see from my family participate. I would see her just demolish both boys and girls during the cross-country run. And I remember her being in both fifth and sixth grade and me being in kindergarten watching her run. And I remember thinking, like, one day I will win Ligonia Olympics just like my sister did. My sister and I were both born in Mexico. And as little kids, we immigrated to the U.S. I was about to be 3. She was almost 9. And for anyone who grows up with an older sister, the experience we have, it's like growing up with a second mom. Someone you look up to, someone that inspires you, someone you struggle with. In the early years, we started school and we were taught in Spanish, and then eventually transitioned to English. And so we both struggled together with my brother as well, learning English together. I remember coming home and crying, trying to understand what in the world the book said and what our homework actually was. As time went on, we laughed, we played, we enjoyed life together. She got married. About 2 years, 3 years later, I got married, raised our children together. We're very similar, my sister and I, in many, many ways. Same desires, same ambition, the wit, the jokes. It's outside of my wife. My sister is someone who always got me, really understood who I am and why I would do the things that I do. When I got the news that my sister got sick, she texted me, and then she called and we talked. And she wasn't worried, which made me not worry too much. And then 2 weeks later, I'm in class, and I get a text from my brother-in-law. And the text says, I'm taking Letty to the emergency in Loma Linda. She is not feeling so well. And at that point, I began to worry. So I texted her immediately and texted my brother-in-law. I started a group thread with my brother, my other sister, my younger sister, Lori, and my brother, Salvador, and my brother-in-law, Luis, my wife, Paulina, and Letty. And I texted like, hey, please give me an update whenever you get a chance. Just know that I'm praying for you. And around midnight on, I think it was Wednesday night, the night she went in, I receive a text, we all did, from my sister. And she says, I'm feeling much better right now. But I just feel really tired and weak. And little did we know that that was the last thing that we would hear from her. From there on, the next day she was intubated. The Friday that followed, I flew out to California. And 12 days later, after we were done praying for her, she passed. She passed away. She died. Grief is not something that you get over. Grief is not something that can be fixed. It's not something that is mended. It's not like a broken bone. It's not a paper cut. It's something that happens. It just is. And you have to learn how to walk with it and carry it around where you go And it manifests differently. It'll look differently for different people. For some, it'll be short. For some, it'll be long. And there's no formula for how you grieve. So as I think of just myself and my family, I think of myself and my family, and my dad wanted to work the next day, and so he went to work. We're a working family. That's all we've known. That's all my dad has known for most of his life. So that's what became his normal. And I think working for my dad has helped him process the loss of my sister. My mom wept and still continues to weep. I don't think a day has gone by since my sister has passed that my mom doesn't weep. For my niece, Vanessa, and my nephews, Alex and Adrian, for them, there's like this numbness that comes and that came because it's a reality, but it's surreal at the same time. So there's that. For my sister, Lori, she finds herself, and I echo what she says, and that's, you know, she finds herself, and I find myself getting frustrated at some really nice comments that people will say to us. And my brother-in-law, he's worried, and he's experiencing the loneliness that comes with the loss. And so I think it's affected us all in different ways, and we're still learning. We're still in this process of learning how to walk with the grief that we carry. Learning to live in grief is just weird and sucky. Really sucky. Because as humans, this is the weird thing, and this is like the weird thing even for me, is we live in these paradoxes. And so, like, for instance, this paradox that we experience is no one can live your life. No one can struggle the way you struggle. No one can overcome the things that you have to overcome. No one can experience what you will experience. And so in that sense, you have to do it alone. But yet at the same time, we can't do life alone. And so so that's one paradox. And the other thing is we are here as human beings in this world we experience two opposite spectrums. And that is love and loss. Like, it's what we experience. And you cannot experience love without eventually one day inevitably experiencing loss. And if we live in such a way where we try to avoid pain, suffering, and loss, then we will never truly love. And so the grief, the grief that I have, it's not something to be, it's not something like to be fixed, it's not something to get rid of, it's not something to get over, it's something to be in, if that makes any sense. It's like, we have to allow ourselves to be in it and carry it. And so personally, it's why you will see me crying. There have been moments where I will be in a mid-jog and the random memory will come to mind, and I'll just pause and cry for like 2 to 3 minutes, and then sometimes I'll push forward and keep jogging, and sometimes I won't, and it just is what it is. The other thing, I don't know if it's, I'm sure it is, I think it's the result is it helps me get through it. My sister was an awesome human being, and I want the world to know that. And so by me living in my grief and by me remembering the memory that I have of her and the legacy that she lives and she left behind allows me to I don't want to say hold on to the memories, because I don't think I'm ever going to let them go. But it's more like it allows me to relive everything good that I've ever shared with her, and to allow other people to live that experience with me, to see maybe what can be even for them. Right now, I guess, the thing that is helping me get through this is learning that it's okay for me not to be okay. That it's okay for me to accept that this is my reality right now. This is what is. It's gonna be different. My family gatherings, Christmas, New Year, will all be different. One day, we will have a huge family reunion, and that's heavenly. But as for now, this is our current reality. And for me personally, like I love the idea and the hope that we have, and the hope that I have in being able, knowing, like just having such confidence that I know I will see her again, and that we will enjoy life again, and probably way better than we ever enjoyed it here. There's no doubt in my mind on that aspect. And when I think of that, there's like this, again, it's like a paradox. I am super excited that I will one day see her again, and we'll run together, we'll laugh together, we'll joke together, and do life together. And at the same time, knowing that that can't happen tomorrow or today hurts. And it sucks. And so, as I wait, as we wait, I hope that I can do everything possible to help point people to that same hope, so that one day we can have this just awesome, huge family gathering and just do life and enjoy life once again. At the end of the day, I hope we choose to just love a little more. Knowing that sometimes love is very brutal. And oftentimes love asks us to do more than what we're actually able to do. But that's my hope. My name is Ignacio Silverio. This is my story. What's yours?